definitely. Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
All right. Thank you very much for being here, for attending this speech, because I know it's difficult in Spain. We will do... we will be doing siesta this time, so it's something very, very good for the health. Okay, we are going to speak about one ultra-secret chat application, or just say script, because many of the things we do are proof of concept, just programmed in Python, because as you know, it's much easier than coding in C, for example, but in any kind of proof of concepts, because if you are going to develop some things for production, you won't use at the end Python. You will translate the code to C, for example, because you will have more performance. And for packet manipulation, it's necessary to have a lot of performance. Okay, not too much. I won't leave you time to read everything, but if you want, you can just follow me in Twitter or in LinkedIn, and I'll respond. The only things I respond are Twitter and LinkedIn. You don't need to try to contact with Facebook or something like that, because I don't use this kind of social networks. Okay, let us talk about that data exfiltration. Exfiltration is something that is made more and more during the last years. You have heard in 2016 there have been a lot of data leaks, very important data leaks in big companies, in governments, and in many places. And as you know, the defenses are each day more and more robust and safely, but still there have been a lot of data leaks, even if the defense are increasing every day. So data exfiltration, one of the things is that it requires physical access or access, of course. I won't speak about data exfiltration remotely. I have to have physical access. Yes, physical, or let us say logical, but I have to have any kind of access that I can be inside of the network. It's used to, of course, to steal information. Sometimes it's like the Tor network. It will be used for privacy, but it's just a bad explanation of the usage. Usually it's used to steal information of security facilities. Requires strict data access prevention and DLP techniques. Yes, it's very difficult to control the data exfiltration. That's the reason, because there have been a lot of leaks in the last years. So it's difficult to control that you are being stolen. In governments and security corporate environments, it's difficult to succeed. Yes, because they have a lot of as HoneyNets and IDS, IPS, DLP systems that will try to lock and to control everything that's been touched and that's been taken outside. If some of you have worked in intelligence facilities or in secure government facilities, you will see that there are no mobile phones, pen drives are not possible to enter inside, and there are a lot of controls doesn't let you steal data from them. So it's difficult to get data outside. Traditional methods are more creative methods. When we talk about data exfiltration, and when we talk, of course, about covert channels, many of us, we are thinking about DNS, data exfiltration, ICMP, ARP. There are a lot of protocols in the last years that have been used for data exfiltration using covert channels. It's difficult to control the transmission of data using these protocols, because packets are not supposed to be what they are doing. So it's very difficult to control by systems, security systems. When the main channels are secure, data exfiltration gets difficult. That's it. So there, you have to look into more creative ways to do it. Information hiding using covert channels or hidden channels. That's what we are talking about. In introducing modifications in protocols or payloads inside protocols to permit that these protocols are going to be used to other things that are, they are supposed to do. For example, DNS, for example. There have to be a shared resource for sender and receiver. There has to be a synchronization. That means if I'm going to steal the data using a covert channel, using, for example, ICMP, there has to be an IP address inside and an IP address outside to synchronize the data between them. Sometimes it's not easy to do. And you have to elude standard hardware, firmware, software to be able to do that. Sometimes it's just doing modifications in protocol. Python is a good help for doing it. And some libraries of packet manipulation are very good for doing or creating covert channels. We are going to speak today about layer two, data exfiltration using covert channels. We are taking, in this case, in the case of layer two, we are trying to take advantage of technology and standards. That means we will use the standards to modify them and to be able to use hardware, for example, in my case, a monitor mode Wi-Fi card to transmit packets that normally should be layer 2 802.11 packets, but I have modified them to be able to make inside some payload, to put inside some payload, but trying to look as standard Wi-Fi packets. That's it. And if we are speaking about channel, the channels, the covert channels, have to be undetectable and interceptable. That's a good covert channel. A covert channel that you can just look at the traffic, and it seems normal traffic or maybe malformed traffic, and it's difficult to intercept. Because many times when we modify the protocols, the standards, the normal Wi-Fi cards that you will have at your sensors or at your computers will just detect some malformed packets and will just silently discard them. So it's difficult to analyze that my packets, my malformed packets, are just the good packets for covert channel. So the sensors will not make an alarm or trigger an alarm, because they will not be able just to read the packets, because they are malformed. So that's an advantage also. And the only way is being clearly sniffing packets and trying to recognize them by patterns, maybe, or to know the way we are doing the covert channel. So it's like the honeypot's speech. The only trick is my covert channel application, my script, is just my script. I haven't to share it with you, because you will read the code and you will understand what I'm doing with the packets. In the case of Python, of course, or in the case of other programming languages, you just will try to reverse the code to understand what I'm doing with the packets. So that's the only way of trying to sniff and recognize my patterns. The data obfuscation and encryption is what we are going to use. We are going not only to use a covert channel, a normal covert channel manipulating packets, we are also going to obfuscate the packets to not being reached by other sniffers, and also we will use encryption. That's a probe request frame in 802.11 protocol. That's a typical probe request. That's the typical probe request that, for example, a smartphone asks for a network. Just saying, okay, I would like to connect to this network. Is there this network on the air now, here, in my coverage area? So that's it. If you see the normal frame, 802.11 frame, you will see there's a frame control field with all these flags inside. There's the duration, the address 1, address 2, address 3, and address 4, the sequence counter, this is just the number, and the frame body, and then the checksum of the frame. That's a normal management frame, for example, or data frame in Wi-Fi protocol. I will just try to use some of the fields that I read on the frame, and I will modify them to be used by my own protocol. So I will include, for example, in the address one, that's the destination address, one specific address. So every of the let's say nodes that will be hearing the air will just know that by one specific MAC address, this is the traffic for them. Okay, so that's my, let us say, that's my telephone number. I will put here the remote address, and what about the source address? In every packet that I send to the air, I will randomize it. Okay, so it's difficult to recognize any pattern that all the packets are generated by one physical address. No, every packet will have another one, another different one. In the address 3, that's the receiver address, I will also use the remote address, the same one. I will use a sequence counter for me, yes, because let's say I want to see which packet is unique on the network, because I won't send each packet one time in Wi-Fi. This is impossible to reach the destination. You will need like send 100 times each packet, and there maybe 100 meters away somebody's hearing, the remote node is hearing and detecting my packets maybe once every 100 packets that I send. So it's enough, but I have to discard the other ones, the other repetitions. So I will use the sequence counter as my unique packet counter. And about the frame body, what will I do with the frame body? I will include something that is inside of the standards, that the name is information elements, the IE fields, and I will use them as containers where I will put information. For example, I will put nothing inside of the in the ACID or in the SSID, because it's easy to recognize by any system, so I don't want to be recognized. I will keep it empty. But in some of these strange 802.11 fields, I will put, for example, the user ID, because we are speaking about the chat application. So each user will have like a unique ID to be recognized inside of the network. And with this script, there will be possibly many, not only one, receivers, many participants. It will be a chat application for many users. So I will put my user ID, and I will cipher then the cipher username plus the sequence counter, just to recognize that this packet is unique for one user, because maybe two different nodes will repeat the same sequence counter. So I will keep track of repeated sequence counters, and I need another field. This is the cipher username. And then I will include inside of other fields, as this one, for example, this WPS field of the probe request, I will include, for example, the message that we are going to transmit, or a file part of a file that I'm going to send. Okay, so that's the way I'll make a modification of each packet. That can be, of course, and has to be the bag with sniffers, like wires, of course, that we are using always. So you see, that's one of the packets. It's a normal probe request packet, okay? And I include a lot of fields inside. Inside of each one, there's information that I'm sending, okay? Okay, what do we need to use this this script? We will need to use monitor mode, Linux operating system, Python, and packet manipulation library. I recommend SCAPI, that is very easy to use, and it's very and it's very good for manipulating low level packets. With SCAPI, you will see that. Let us see the demo, and you will see how it works. Okay, here. Okay, I want you to check how I'm constructing in SCAPI, in Python and Python, one probe request packet. Okay, I forge it, and if you see, a packet has a lot of layers, .11, radio tab header, a lot of headers and layers. So I'm just putting what I want to put inside the info of every information element. For example, the message, for example, the payload, the command I'm going to use. So that's what we are doing. At the end, we are just constructing the packet and then sending it a lot of times. It's fully configurable. You can put 100 times each packet or whatever, what it depends on. And I'm also using the nodes as repeaters, because Wi-Fi has not a big curvature. So everyone that receives the packet from another node will repeat it 100 times to the air. So we are increasing the curvature of the network. And what about how does it work? You will see it here. I start the application. I enter the interface, the parent interface I'm going to use. In my case, I have two. In my computer, I have WLAN2. And WLAN1, okay? So it creates automatically a monitor mode interface, MON1 and MON2, and you will enter your alias, your nickname inside of the chat, okay? And Bob, Alice, whatever. And this is the most important. You will create a room, a private room for you. That means that this word is the most important, because from this word will be derived the AES encryption, okay? And also the destination address of this chat room. So everybody will send the packets to this address. And also the channel. The channel is also derived from the secret room. So it has to be a strong authentication. So here it is. For example, I say, Bob, hi. Okay, and say, how are you? Okay, and the other node that's maybe 100 meters away will receive, how are you? Okay, I can include a file, a picture, whatever. We have like special commands, like for example, let me see, this is English keyboard, file, for example, dummy txt, sending file dummy txt. I put in class some commands like which are the users connected, etc, and you will see commands inside of the chat application as an all IRC program. You will have special commands inside, okay? And at last, and the last one, that's the conclusion. Okay, it's very difficult to detect the packets in the air, The difficulties always in Wi-Fi are the drivers, injection capabilities of the monitor mode card that you are using for this kind of scripts. Because, for example, if you use a monitor mode, any monitor mode card, it can maybe not inject malformed packets in the air. So it's sometimes it's difficult to find the right hardware for doing that. And it's difficult also to implement anti-detection techniques, but using this kind of covert channel, it's easy.
Thank you so much, Yago. Very interesting. I think we're going to see a lot more of this. Go ahead.
The two chat participants have to be in the same reach, right? They have to see each other or...
Yes, of course, in Wi-Fi coverture, let us say, they have to be about 50 to 100 meters away. But in buildings, for example, big buildings, you can have like more participants and everyone will act as a repeater of the packets. So you will be increasing the length of the distance you can reach.
Okay, we're running a little bit behind. If that's okay, we can maybe continue the discussion in one of the breakout rooms. I think that's really interesting.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Thank you.